In many areas of the Great Lakes, whitefish are struggling to maintain their population, but one experiment aims to help them out by reintroducing them to their historic spawning runs.
If you're from the Great Lakes, you're probably familiar with whitefish. They're an important food source for both other fish and humans. In Great Lakes commercial fishing, they generate more income than any other catch.
Whitefish are the most important commercial fishery in the Great Lakes, going back millennia to Native Americans in the region.
Matt Herbert is a senior conservation scientist with the Nature Conservancy in Michigan. He says that for his family and for many tourists, whitefish are an important part of vacationing in the Great Lakes region.
When we go up north, whitefish are an important part of our tourist experience. You know, we always go buy a smoked whitefish and crackers and eat on that. People in our region are familiar with going up north and having whitefish at restaurants and buying smoked whitefish.
But lake whitefish are in trouble. It began over 100 years ago during the logging boom of the 1800s when sediment and sawdust from lumber operations flooded into local rivers, the same rivers where many whitefish would lay their eggs.
All the sediment that was delivered to our rivers through that deforestation and all that activity, all of those things kind of combined to like really kind of destroy the habitat that they use and block their access to other habitats. Once we lost those runs, we did not have adults that associated spawning with rivers.
Luckily, whitefish also spawn in the Great Lakes themselves, using rocky reefs to safely house their eggs. Pollution, overfishing, and the introduction of invasive sea lampreys caused a major population crash in the 1950s. But thanks to improving environmental conditions and intervention from fishery managers, populations were booming by the end of the 20th century.
Whitefish, unlike some of those other species, recovered in the 1980s. And so in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s, we actually had really good whitefish numbers.
Today, though, whitefish populations are struggling once again. In 2023, Lake Michigan's commercial whitefish harvest was less than half of what it was in 2012 and less than a third of what it was in 1990.
Over the last 15 years or so, we've seen another decline in whitefish in Lake Michigan and in Lake Huron. In the lower lakes, in Lake Erie and Lake Ontario, whitefish never really came back from those historic crashes. We're not seeing young fish that are part of the population. And so the consensus is there's a bottleneck at that really young stage after they hatch from an egg that they're not finding enough food resources.
There could be a few reasons why whitefish aren't making it to adulthood, but according to Scott Hansen, fisheries biologist for the Wisconsin Department of Natural Resources, there's a likely culprit.
Invasive species, we believe, particularly the dry-scented mussels, are likely responsible for much of what's going on out there.
Dry-scented mussels are the zebra and quagga mussels you've probably heard about. They arrived on ships from Europe in the 80s, and since then, they've carpeted the bottom of the lower lakes, sucking much-needed nutrients out of the water.
They interrupted the base of the food web, so essentially we've taken out that phytoplankton, zooplankton base of the food chain that those young fish need to have.
Lake Superior's whitefish population has been more stable than the other lakes. The lake's cold water is perfect for whitefish spawning, and it doesn't have nearly as many invasive mussels. But as lake temperatures increase and habitats are altered due to climate change, even Lake Superior whitefish might have trouble finding suitable areas to lay eggs.
Lake whitefish spawn on cooling temperatures, so we need to have clean, cold, well-oxygenated water for those eggs to survive and then to hatch. If our water continues to warm up, that cold water area that they have to have at certain times of the year is going to get smaller and smaller.
So, if whitefish are losing ground to warmer temperatures and invasive species, where can they go? Rivers may offer a solution. In the mid-90s, biologists in Wisconsin were surprised to see whitefish spawning in rivers flowing into Green Bay, which hadn't been seen since the late 1800s.
Whitefish found their way back into the rivers in Wisconsin in the mid-1990s. The first evidence was, I believe, 1994 in the Menominee River. We started looking in these other rivers, first found them in the Fox River, then in the Peshtigo, then in the Oconto rivers. And that hasn't occurred in over a century.
Nobody knows why whitefish returned to Green Bay tributaries, but it's a good sign for the health of the rivers.
And all the work that's been done in these rivers as areas of concern and rehabilitating these rivers, cleaning them up, has provided the opportunity and good conditions for whitefish to spawn.
That spawning is one reason why Green Bay has a relatively stable whitefish population. There's an effort to recreate the success throughout the Great Lakes, starting in Michigan.
If we can get whitefish spawning in rivers of the Great Lakes, that should provide food resources for them to help them increase survival at that young stage and help to rebuild populations in Lake Michigan and Lake Huron.
And that's just what the Nature Conservancy, the Michigan Department of Natural Resources, the Bay Mills Indian Community, the Sioux Tribe of Chippewa Indians, and the Little Traverse Bay Bands of Odawa Indians have all joined forces to do. Chris Dye manages the Little Traverse Bay Band's hatchery in Levering, Michigan, just south of the Mackinac Bridge.
We'll go up there, we'll put the eggs in the river, we'll let them hatch out naturally, and hopefully they will imprint to that river.
In the fall, eggs were collected from wild-caught whitefish in Elk Rapids, Michigan. The eggs were raised in the hatchery until they were eyed up, or until their eyes were visible. In February, they were ready to go into incubators.
They're in-stream incubators, so we'll put fish eggs in all these little holes, all these little cells, and fill them up, and we'll put two together, and that'll enclose, make a little plate for us. And so we'll put roughly about 2,000 whitefish eggs in a plate.
Dye and the hatchery team loaded more than 100,000 eggs into incubators bound for the bottom of the Jordan River, about 40 miles south of the hatchery. This is one of the three rivers that's been stocked with whitefish for the project. The researchers are hopeful that the baby whitefish will spend the first period of their lives in these rivers, where there should be enough food to help them mature before venturing out into the lakes.
We have these anchors that we'll clip them onto, and they'll kind of hold in the water. And so that'll give the eggs a chance to be in the river, to imprint, to do their thing. And when they hatch, they should be able to emerge and hopefully drift downriver like they would naturally. We are estimating right now the eggs are going to hatch in about 4 weeks. We believe that when they hatch, that's when they have that cue for them to imprint and want to come back.
After putting them in water, the hatchery staff kept track of the water temperature to predict when the eggs would hatch. Once the temperature was right, they sampled the river for newly hatched whitefish.
A lot of larvae, fish that spawn in rivers, they'll actually wait till the middle of the night and they'll get up in the water column and they'll drift down the river. And if we put a little net out there, we can actually catch and have like a subsample of who's drifting down the river. And if we set this up below our incubators, we can see how many fish left the incubator and went downstream.
About a month after putting the incubators in the water, they found something.
Those are what we're finding. So those are little baby whitefish.
Will these baby whitefish be able to reach adulthood? And will they return to this river to spawn? We'll have to wait to find out.
This isn't going to restore all of Lake Michigan, but if we figure out how to do it, we'll be able to scale this up and we'll be able to apply this elsewhere. So in 5 to 7 years, they may return and we'll know for sure that it worked.